From Ballymena Free Presbyterian Church, we present Let the Bible Speak. It's good to have you with us today as we spend 15 minutes around the Word of God, preaching Christ in all His fullness. And this is Leslie Curran saying hello and welcome to the program. I'm delighted you're tuning in once again as the Reverend John Greer, minister of Ballymena Free Presbyterian Church, is back with us to Let the Bible Speak.
And this is John Greer welcoming you to Let the Bible Speak. We are glad to be able to address you today and bring to you God's precious Word. I want to invite you to come to our church services. They're held every Lord's Day at 11:30 and 6:30 for the main worship services. We also have Sunday School Hour at 10 o'clock and an adult Bible class at 10:15. And we look forward to having you come and join with us. You will be very welcome, and may God bless His Word to your heart today as you continue to listen in. Thank you for joining with us today on this very first day of another year. I want to take the opportunity of thanking all our listeners for tuning in during the year gone by, and it is my prayer that you'll continue to do so as this new year begins and we enter out into it. It is a very solemn thing in a sense that we stand at the threshold of another year, and we do not know what it will bring or what it holds for any of us. But we rejoice today that there is one who knows the future, one who understands all of the paths that we will have to tread, because He has already gone before us. And if you are a believer, that can be your great confidence as you enter into another year. And if you're not a child of God, then we pray that today you might consider that most important matter, even as you stand at this juncture in your life, and we all enter into another year together. May you seek the Lord while He may be found, and call upon Him while He is near. I want to bring your attention today to some words that are found in John's Gospel, the first chapter. They are found twice in that chapter. They are the great words of John the Baptist, where he cries, "Behold the Lamb of God." What words those are to consider at the threshold of another year. Behold the Lamb of God, John 1:29 and John 1 and the verse number 36. John repeated his sermon. Sometimes preachers have to bring the same message again to get the attention of their listeners. And this is what John does here in this particular incident, where he is the forerunner of Jesus Christ. He's preparing the way for the Lord. And as he does so, he identifies Christ in this manner: "Behold the Lamb of God." As a title, is only ever used in John's writings, that is, the title "The Lamb of God." It is used here in these two verses, in John 1:29 and 36, and then it's also found in the book of Revelation, and it's found in that book 28 times. It's used as a title of the Lord to signify that He is the fulfillment of a very special Old Testament type. In the Old Testament scriptures, the Lamb is the most prominent type of Christ in terms of the animal sacrifices. And in being a type of Christ, the Lamb provides a vital study with regard to God's way of salvation. We may think of the provision of the Lamb. The first mention of the Lamb as a sacrifice is in Genesis 22 and verse number 7, where you have Isaac's pertinent question, "Where is the Lamb for a burnt offering?" A question that shows that the sacrificing of the Lamb was already a well-known and well-established feature of Old Testament worship. Isaac's question reveals that God had clearly set before His ancient people, the Jews, the centrality of the Lamb and the entire sacrificial system. And therefore we have Abraham's response in verse 8, "God will provide Himself a Lamb for a burnt offering." That's an important statement, a prophecy actually, revealing that it had been revealed that God would provide a Lamb for the redemption of men. And Abraham was aware of this revelation. And therefore the one provided would be God's Lamb, the Lamb of God, as our text states. The revelation was in the terms of the covenant of grace, in which the Lord had decreed that the salvation of sinners could only be accomplished by the sacrificial death of a substitute. This was at the very heart of God's covenant purpose for the redemption of men, salvation by the blood sacrifice. 1 Peter 1, 18-20 tell us very clearly, those verses tell us very clearly that redemption is by blood. It says we're not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Christ. So redeemed by blood, it is Christ's blood. It goes on to say in verse 20, as of a lamb, without spot and without blemish, foreordained before the foundation of the world. So we are redeemed by blood. It's the blood of Christ. He is God's Lamb, and he was divinely appointed from all eternity to be the Lamb of God. Essentially in view in these words, there is the covenant of grace, God's merciful plan for man's salvation from sin, and it's centered on Christ and his sacrificial death, presented here under the type of the Lamb. So when John described Christ as the Lamb of God, he was using the title that is intimately and inseparably associated with God's covenant purpose to save sinners. Then there is the purity of the Lamb as well as the provision of the Lamb. Being the Lamb of God, the one provided to save sinners, is spotless and pure in character. The title, the Lamb of God, suggests one coming out from God to be the Lamb for sinners, therefore necessarily pure. God would provide only a lamb without blemish and without spot. Again, I refer you to 1 Peter 1:19. Notice here in John 1 how the text commences. John sees Christ coming toward him, coming from his temptation in the wilderness. There's a sequence of events in view here. There is the baptism of the Lord, then there was his temptation in the wilderness, and then his public emergence. And this is the point that's in view in verse 29. The next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him, and saith, Behold, the Lamb of God. But you see, in his temptation that immediately preceded his public appearance to be the Saviour of men, his purity had been established and had been fully revealed. The devil tempted Christ, but it was only to be found and to be revealed that Christ not only did not sin, but that he could not sin. And that is a point that's of great importance, the impeccability of Jesus Christ, his absolute purity. That is, he had a humanity that not only was without sin, but a humanity that could not sin, because he was the God-man, both God and man, the two natures in one person. And therefore, there is the Lamb's purity. And how important that is for sinners to recognize. Because you need a Savior who is without sin. You need a Savior who is absolutely pure. And that Savior is Jesus Christ. He is, therefore, the Lamb without spot and without blemish. The personification of the Lamb. It was revealed by God that the Lamb would be a man. Isaiah 53 verse 7, he is led as a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before her shears is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. So Isaiah 53 prophesied that Christ, the appointed Son of God, the appointed Lamb of God, would be a man. And here in our text, John the Baptist points to Christ, the God-man, and identifies him as God's Lamb. It was shown that he who would save men must be a man, one of the same nature as those he came to save. This is essential. This was absolutely essential, because the original representative of men was a man, the first Adam, that is, the one who was made by God and placed in the garden and put under the command not to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He was under a test. Would he love God sufficiently so he would obey him? And that test was essential, because the original representative of man was a man, this first man Adam, and if he failed, then there had to be another raised up if men were to be saved, one who would come along as, well, the Bible calls him this, the last Adam, the second man, the Lord Jesus Christ. And therefore, the Lamb of God must be a man because the first man failed, and there needs to be another man who will not fail. And thank God he did not fail. Christ came and he lived under the law, he obeyed the law fully, and he gave complete satisfaction to the law of Almighty God. But that leads us on to the punishment of the Lamb. Because we find here in John 1 a very interesting detail. And that is that in verse 19, it was priests and Levites who were sent to inquire of John, men who were associated with the sacrificial system of Israel, men who would have been involved in the slaughter and sacrifice of lambs in the temple morning and evening. And therefore, against the background of the inquiries of these men, it was entirely appropriate that John uttered this cry, "Behold the Lamb of God." He was announcing that Christ would be punished for the sins of men, involving all the suffering that he endured. And therefore, there is very clearly the punishment of the Lamb involved in this title, the Lamb of God. The Lamb was that little creature that was sacrificed morning and evening, as we've indicated. And therefore, for Christ to be the Lamb of God, he must also die. He must take the place of the sinner and suffer in his stead. And thank God he did. And therefore, what a price he paid. It was the price of his own death. It was the price of his own blood shedding. It was the payment that was demanded by divine justice. And thank God Christ made that payment, that sinners like you may go free if you will but trust in the Lamb of God. And then there's the preeminence of the Lamb. The final view of Christ, the Lamb, is in Revelation, the book of Revelation, as I've already noted with you 28 times. The title is used there of Jesus Christ, but always in a place of preeminence in heaven. And the point is that since the glory of heaven centres on Christ the Lamb, there is no other way into heaven but by him, through him. It is through the Lamb of God. And we have this sealed to us in Revelation, for example, in Revelation 7, 14 and 15, where it refers to the great multitude around the throne of God and of the Lamb. And they say to Christ, or of Christ, that he is worthy because he has redeemed them to God by his own blood. And therefore the Lamb is preeminent in heaven. And the point is, no man can ever be in heaven except through the Lamb of God, and by faith in his atoning blood. Seek the Lord this day. If you're not a converted sinner, if you're not saved by grace, if you're still on the road to destruction, you need to seek the Lord and come to him on his terms and trust in his own dear Son and find peace and joy in believing, even through the Lamb of God who was sent forth to bear away the sins of the world.
You've been listening to Let the Bible Speak. If we can be of any further spiritual help, we invite you to contact us via our website at www.ballymenafpc.org, on our Facebook at facebook.com/BallymenaFPC, or via our phone number 2565-2895. You may hear Mr. Greer preach each Lord's Day here in Ballymena Free Presbyterian Church at 11:30 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. We assure you of a warm welcome at all of the services and look forward to having you with us. Thank you for listening today. May the Lord richly bless you. And don't forget to tune in next week at the same time as once again we turn to the Scriptures and let the Bible speak.